Harper Audio presents 1421, The Year China Discovered America, by Gavin Menzies, read by Simon Vance.
This book is dedicated to my beloved wife Marcella, who has traveled with me on the journeys related in this book and through life. The countries beyond the horizon and at the ends of the earth have all become subjects, and to the most western of the western or the most northern of the northern countries, however far away they may be. Part of an inscription on a memorial stone erected by Admiral Zheng He at Changlo on the banks of the Yangtze estuary in 1431. Introduction. Over 10 years ago, I stumbled upon an incredible discovery, a clue hidden in an ancient map which, though it did not lead to buried treasure, suggested that the history of the world as it has been known and handed down for centuries would have to be radically revised. I was pursuing an interest that had become a consuming passion for me, medieval history, and in particular the maps and charts of early explorers. I loved to examine these old charts, tracing contours, coastlines, the shifting shapes of shoals and sandbars, the menace of rocks and reefs. I followed the ebb and flow of tides, the pull of unseen currents and the track of prevailing winds, peeling back the layers of meaning contained within the charts. The wintry plains of Minnesota started me on my research. It was not necessarily the first place you would think of to discover a document with such profound implications, but the James Ford Bell Library at the University of Minnesota has a remarkable collection of early maps and charts, and one, in particular, had attracted my attention. It had been in the collection of Sir Thomas Phillips, a wealthy British collector born in the late 18th century, but its existence had remained virtually unknown until the collection was rediscovered half a century ago. The chart was dated 1424, and signed by a Venetian cartographer by the name of Zuane Pizzigano. It showed Europe and parts of Africa, and as I compared it with a modern map, I realized that the cartographer had drawn the coastlines of Europe accurately. It was an extraordinary cartographic achievement for that era, but not one of earth-shattering significance in itself. However, my eye was then drawn to the most curious feature of the map. The cartographer had also drawn a group of 4 islands far out in the western Atlantic. The names he gave them, Satanases, Antilia, Saya, and Imana, did not correspond to any modern place names, and there are no large islands in the area where he had positioned them. That could have been a simple error in calculating longitude, for Europeans did not master that difficult art until well into the 18th century. But my first troubling thought was that the islands were imaginary and had existed only in the mind of the man who drew the chart. I looked again. The 2 biggest islands were painted in bold colours, Antilia in dark blue, Satanases in pillarbox red. The rest of the chart was uncoloured, and it seemed certain that Pizzigano wished to emphasise that these were important, recently discovered islands. All the names marked on the chart appeared to be in medieval Portuguese, Antilia, Anti on the opposite side of, and Ilha, island, meant an island on the opposite side of the Atlantic to Portugal. Other than that, there was nothing in the name to help me identify it. Satanases, Satan's or Devil's Island, was a very distinctive name. A greater number of towns were marked on the largest island, Antilia, indicating that it was better known. Satanases had only 5 names and featured the enigmatic words Con and Imana. My interest was now thoroughly aroused. What were these islands? Did they really exist? The date of the map, its provenance and authenticity were unimpeachable, yet if it was genuine, it marked lands in places where, according to the accepted history, no Europeans had ventured for another 7 decades. After several months of examining charts and documents in map rooms and archives, I became convinced that Antilia and Satanases were actually the Caribbean islands of Puerto Rico and Guadeloupe. There were far too many points of similarity between them for it to be a coincidence. but that meant that somebody had accurately surveyed the islands some 70 years before Columbus reached the Caribbean. This seemed an incredible revelation. Columbus had not discovered the New World, yet his voyage had always been regarded as an absolutely defining moment. It marked the point when, led by the Portuguese, Europeans had begun to embark on the great voyages of discovery, the long, restless expansion over the face of the globe that was to characterize the next 500 years. I needed further evidence to support my discovery, and I sought the help of an expert in medieval Portuguese, Professor João Camilo dos Santos, who was then at the Portuguese embassy in London. He examined the Pizzigano chart and corrected my translation of Con Imana to Volcano Erupts There. The words had been placed in the southern part of Satanases, just where there are three volcanoes on Guadeloupe today. Did they erupt before 1424? In high excitement, I rang the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. The volcanoes had erupted twice between 1400 and 1440. But had otherwise been dormant during the previous 100 years and the succeeding 2.5 centuries. Moreover, there were no other volcanic eruptions in the Caribbean at that time. I felt I was home and dry. I believed I had found solid evidence that someone had reached the Caribbean and established a secret colony there 68 years before Columbus. Professor Camilo dos Santos gave me an introduction to the curator of the state archives in the Torre do Tombo in Lisbon, and on a beautiful early autumn afternoon I began further research there, hoping for corroboration of my hunch about Portuguese landings in the Caribbean. To my astonishment, I came across something entirely different. Far from the Portuguese having discovered those Caribbean islands, they were completely unknown to them at the time Pizzigano was drawing his chart. They were, however, shown on another, slightly later chart, drawn by some other, unknown cartographer that had not come into Portuguese hands until 1428. In addition, I found a command issued by the Portuguese prince Henry the Navigator to his sea captains in 1431, ordering them to go and find the islands of Antilia shown on the 1428 chart. Had the Portuguese discovered them, Henry's edict would scarcely have been necessary. But if the Portuguese had not discovered and surveyed Antilia and Satanases, who on earth had? Who had provided Pizzigano and the other cartographers with their information? I began more research, tracing the rise and fall of medieval civilizations that had long since crumbled into dust. In turn, I eliminated virtually every navy in the world that could feasibly have undertaken such an ambitious voyage in the early decades of the 15th century. Venice, the oldest and most powerful naval power in Europe, was in disarray. The old Doge was ill, his powers waning, and his successor was waiting in the wings, determined that Venice should abandon its maritime tradition and become a land power. Northern European powers barely had the ships to cross the English Channel, let alone explore new worlds. The Egyptian rulers were mired in civil wars. There were no fewer than 5 sultans in 1421 alone. The Islamic world was also disintegrating. The Portuguese had invaded its North African heartlands, and the once mighty Asian empire of the Mongol Emperor Tamerlane was in pieces. Who else could have explored the Caribbean? I decided to see if there were other charts, like the 1424 map, showing continents that had been surveyed before the European voyages of discovery. The deeper I dug, the more bombshells I uncovered. I was astonished to find that Patagonia and the Andes had been mapped a century before the first Europeans sighted them, and Antarctica had been accurately drawn some 4 centuries before Europeans reached the continent. The east coast of Africa was shown on another chart, with longitudes that were perfectly correct, something Europeans did not manage to achieve for another 3 centuries. Australia appeared on another map 3 centuries before Cook, and other charts showed the Caribbean, Greenland, the Arctic, and the Pacific and Atlantic coasts of both North and South America long before Europeans arrived. To have drawn maps of the entire world with such accuracy, these explorers, whoever they were, must have circumnavigated the globe. He must have been skilled in astro-navigation, and must have found a method of determining longitude to draw maps with negligible longitude errors. To cover the enormous distances involved, they must have been able to sail the oceans for months at a time, and that would have meant desalinating seawater. As I was later to discover, they also prospected and mined for metals, and they were skilled horticulturalists, transplanting animals and plants right across the globe. In short, they had changed the face of the medieval world. I seemed to be looking at a series of the most incredible journeys in the history of mankind, but one that had been completely expunged from human memory, the majority of records destroyed, the achievements ignored and finally forgotten. These revelations were both astounding and horrifying. If I was to pursue them, I would be challenging some of the most basic assumptions about the history of the exploration of the world. Every schoolchild knows the names of the great European explorers and navigators whose exploits have resounded down the ages. Bartolomeu Dias, circa 1450 to 1500, left Portugal in 1487 and became the first man to round the Cape of Good Hope, the southern tip of Africa. He was driven to the south of the Cape by a storm, and when he found no land, he turned north, rounding the Cape and making landfall on the east coast of Africa. Vasco da Gama, circa 1469 to 1525, followed in Dias's wake 10 years later. He sailed up the east coast of Africa and crossed the Indian Ocean to India, opening up the first sea route for the spice trade. On the 12th of October 1492, Christopher Columbus, 1451 to 1506, sighted land in the modern Bahamas. He has gone down in history as the first European to glimpse the New World, though Columbus himself never appreciated this, believing that he had actually reached Asia. He made 3 further voyages, discovering many of the Caribbean islands and the mainland of Central America. Ferdinand Magellan, circa 1480 to 1521, followed Columbus, and is credited with the discovery of the strait between the Atlantic and the Pacific that bears his name to this day. His ship continued west to complete the first circumnavigation of the world, though Magellan did not survive to see the expedition's triumphant return to Spain, having been killed in the Philippines on the 27th of April 1521. All these men owed a huge debt to the great figure of Henry the Navigator, 1394 to 1460, the Portuguese prince whose base in southwest Portugal became an academy for explorers, cartographers, shipwrights, and instrument makers. There, the design of European ships was revolutionized, navigational instruments and techniques developed and improved, and impetus given to the great voyages of exploration and colonization. As I ended my researches in the Torre do Tombo, a mood of utter confusion engulfed me. I spent a misty evening sitting in the bar on Lisbon's waterfront, looking out at Henry the Navigator's statue. His enigmatic smile was one I now understood. We both shared a secret. He had followed others to the New World. The more I brooded, the more intrigued I became. Who were these master mariners who had discovered and charted these new lands and oceans without leaving any trace of having done so other than these enigmatic maps? The identity of the master hand was revealed in a curious way. The coasts of Patagonia, the Andes Mountains, the Antarctic mainland, and the South Shetland Islands had all been drawn with remarkable accuracy on one chart. The distances covered, from Ecuador in the north to the Antarctic Peninsula in the south, were immense. A huge fleet must have been required. There was only one nation at that time with the material resources, the scientific knowledge, the ships, and the seafaring experience to mount such an epic voyage of discovery. That nation was China. But the thought of searching for incontestable proof that a Chinese fleet had explored the world long before the Europeans filled me with dread. An attempt to uncover the details of any event from nearly 6 centuries ago would have been daunting enough, but this one was made even more difficult by one massive, perhaps insurmountable, obstacle. In the mid-15th century, almost every Chinese map and document of the period was deliberately destroyed by officials of the Chinese court, following an abrupt reversal of its foreign policy. Far from embracing the outside world after these momentous discoveries, China turned in on itself. Anything commemorating.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.